Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to the series called Finance Current Affairs. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try and discuss them with the help of different questions. So before moving on to question number one, if you are there for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon so that you can be notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. The free PDFs of these sessions will be available on that very group only. The link is in the description below. Moving on to question number one then, which says identify the concept. So let's read about this very concept and try and identify what they are talking about. It refers to the ability to convert domestic currency into foreign currencies and vice versa to make the payments for capital accounts POP transactions. So what they are talking about? They are talking about the ability to convert your domestic currency to a foreign currency. Now there are different BOP transactions. Some are current account transactions, some are capital account transactions. So what is BOP? What are current and capital account transactions? We'll be discussing this further in this session. But for your understanding, suppose you want to export or import the goods, okay, or export or import the services, or you want to make investment abroad, you want to invest there, buy their foreign assets. So when you are investing in some foreign country, you need some foreign currency to invest there. You need to convert your domestic currency into the foreign currencies. So the ability to convert this domestic currency into a foreign currency so that you can make the payments in that foreign currency for different transactions you are undertaking over there, that ability is referred to as the convertibility. So when you are converting the domestic currency into foreign currency for your current account transactions, then we call it current account convertibility. And when you are converting this money for your capital account transactions, then we call it the capital account convertibility. So here they are saying that for the capital account transactions, you are having the ability to convert your domestic currency to foreign currency. So what do we call that ability? We call it capital account convertibility. आपको foreign assets में invest करना है, आपको उनको foreign currency में payment करनी पड़ेगी. उसके लिए आपके पास ability होनी चाहिए कि आप अपनी domestic currency को foreign currency में बदल सको. तो उस ability को हम कहते हैं convertibility. और जब हमें ये conversion capital account transactions के लिए करना है, तब हम उसे कहेंगे capital account convertibility. So let's discuss now what is balance of payment, what are current and capital account transactions, and then we'll discuss current and capital account convertibility. So talking about the balance of payments, it's basically a record. And what does it record? It records all the transactions, all the economic transactions that are happening between your country with rest of the world. So aapke country ke jo bhi individuals hain, jo bhi businesses hain, jo bhi governments hain, wo internationally jab koi transactions kar rahe hain, koi economic transactions kar rahe hain with the rest of the world during a certain time period, then that is recorded in the balance of payments account. So usually we prepare it for an year. हर year balance of payment account बनता है जिसमें हम वो सारे economic transactions record करते हैं जो आपकी country के दूसरी country के साथ हो रहे हैं. For example, you are exporting or importing something, you are making FDI, you are making FPI. So all those economic transactions are recorded under the BOP account. If I talk about the two major components of BOP account or how do we classify this BOP account into major heads, then we have the current and the capital account as its major components. So BOP ko hum current or capital account mein divide karte hain. What transactions are included under current account? What are included under capital account? Let's discuss that now. If I talk about the current account, here we cover four types of transactions. So kya four major heads aate hain current account ke under? Jo bhi hum goods export import kar rahe hain, services export import kar rahe hain, un sab ki recording hum current account mein karte hain. All the exports and imports of goods and services are recorded under the current account. Okay, then there are unilateral transfers, one-sided transfers which are happening. For example, you are paying the remittances abroad, or you are receiving the remittance, or you are getting some grant, some aid. All those are the unilateral transfers, one-sided transfers. आपका कोई relative foreign country में है जो आपको पैसे भेज रहा है, then you are receiving the remittances from abroad, or you are getting some grants or aid or some kind of support from abroad. So all these are unilateral transfers, one-sided transfers है ये. then we might have factor income that is also recorded under the current account. Okay, you might have made certain investments abroad, so now you are earning some profit on it, some return on it, or you are earning some rent. So all those things are covered under the factor income. So factor income, unilateral transfer, export import of goods, export import of services, ye major heads hai current account ke. Then we have the capital account. Here we record the change in the foreign assets and the liabilities held by a country. So suppose you are making a foreign direct investment, you are buying some foreign assets, some business abroad, okay, or you are receiving some FDI flows which bring about a change in your assets or liabilities. You might be giving or taking some loans beyond your geographical boundaries of your nation. So those loans, those foreign direct investments, they bring about a change in your assets and liabilities. So those are recorded under the capital account. Jo bhi hum foreign direct investment karte hain ya hamari country mein foreign direct investment aata hai, international borrowing lending hoti hai, wo sab hum capital account mein record karte hain. So these are two major heads, the current and capital account under the BOP. Now, as we discussed about convertibility, it's the ability to convert your domestic currency into foreign currency to make payments for the BOP transactions. You are importing something, okay, some goods are imported. So for that, you need to make the payment. You are buying something from US, you need to pay them in dollars. So you need to convert your rupee into dollars. Okay, the ability to convert your domestic currency into foreign currency is called convertibility. So when these transactions are happening, this conversion is happening for your current account transactions, like for export import or for your unilateral transfers or factor incomes, then it is current account convertibility. And when you are buying some foreign assets, you are making an FDI, you are giving some loan, so for that you need the foreign currency again. So you need to convert your domestic currency into foreign currency for those capital account transactions. So that ability to convert your currency for capital account transactions is called the capital account convertibility. Okay, I hope aapko ye convertibility ka concept clear ho gaya hoga. Simple bhasha mein ye ability hai aapki ki aap apni domestic currency ko foreign currency mein badal pao taki aap internationally transactions kar sako. Now the degree of BOP convertibility depends on the economic development, level of maturity of the financial markets. आपकी financial markets कितनी strong है, कितनी mature है, क्या आप कितनी आपकी economic development है, इस basis पे ये decide हो पाता है कि आपकी convertibility कितनी है. Okay, some countries are there which impose a lot of restrictions on this convertibility. They don't allow easy way of doing the transactions. They impose restrictions on FDIs, FPIs. Some countries are there which don't impose such restrictions. The convertibility is quite smooth over there. So usually the advanced economies have full convertibility, whereas your emerging markets have convertibility but subject to certain, but it varies as per different degrees. Okay, on some very instruments you are offering full convertibility, somewhere you are imposing certain restrictions. So that's what they are talking about. Now you might be thinking why I am discussing BOP convertibility, BOP components right now. Okay, what is something going on currently that I am discussing it? So recently on the RBI website, there was a speech by our Deputy Governor Sri T. Ravi Shankar, which was on the India's capital account management. So there he talked about the BOP, the current capital account, the capital account convertibility and the capital account management in India. So we are discussing his speech only. In this very speech, there are various concepts, which static concepts that can be helpful for you. In this speech, they have talked about capital account convertibility, BOP, current account, capital account. So, these basic concepts will cover. That's why I have picked up this speech and I am discussing it with you all. So, moving ahead now, what is the importance of capital account convertibility? Capital account convertibility is important. Why is it useful? See, there are benefits of internationalization, free capital mobility. If you are able to buy or sell the things abroad, you need to make them the payments in their currency. So for that, convertibility is needed. When investors are coming to your country, your financial markets are going to develop. Okay, so some benefits, if I talk about of capital account convertibility, they are ones related to the internationalization of capital markets, which contribute to growth. So more investors would be coming to your country. Okay, your financial markets will develop. Your financial markets will become more liquid. More money will flow into your economy. Then when the international investors are coming, they want your market to basically improve more. So you can explore on other areas, you can develop your market infrastructure, you can develop your market practices. So zyada se zyada investors attract honge. Okay, zyada investors aayenge, zyada paisa aayega aapki economy mein, liquidity badhegi, financial markets aapki develop hongi. और उससे प्रेशर बढ़ेगा कि आप और इम्प्रूव करो, आपका इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर आप डेवलप करोगे, सो उससे ओवरऑल आपकी मार्केट्स डेवलप होंगी, राइट? सो इंटरनेशनल कैपिटल मार्केट्स इनेबल एक्सेस टू ग्लोबल सेविंग्स पूल एंड फैसिलिटेट एंड टू डिफरेंट करेंसी विच कैन पोटेंशियली रिड्यूस योर बोरोइंग कॉस्ट, फैसिलिटेट रिस्क एलोकेशन एंड इनहेंस ग्लोबल लिक्विडिटी. So more money is flowing into the economy, you can use that money to lend, it will become easier to borrow at a lower cost, okay? Then you can also go abroad, invest elsewhere. This way you can diversify your portfolio, diversify the risks which are associated. You are not just restricted to one country, you can invest in instruments of other countries as well. So it can help you diversify your portfolio, your risks. And then overall, the liquidity will be enhanced globally when there are investors going abroad, coming to your country. And this will be possible when free convertibility is allowed. Now, with some benefits comes certain negative aspects as well. So there are various risks associated with going international. There can be the exposure to the global shocks, credit asset bubbles, exchange rate volatility will be there, okay? Then contagion effects. Now if one country is negatively impacted and others are linked to it, there is convertibility, your currency, you are converting your currency into their currency, you are investing elsewhere, so if some problem is there in that country, then the effects will come in your country as well. Aapke yahan pe के इन्वेस्टर्स, आपके कंट्री के इन्वेस्टर्स ने दूसरी कंट्री में इन्वेस्ट किया हुआ है या दूसरी कंट्री के इन्वेस्टर्स ने आपके यहाँ की मार्केट्स में इन्वेस्ट किया हुआ है, तो दोनों में से कोई भी एक मार्केट नेगेटिवली इंपैक्ट होगी तो उसके इफेक्ट्स बाकी दूसरी कंट्री पे भी जाएंगे. वी हैव सीन ड्यूरिंग द ग्लोबल फाइनेंशियल क्राइसिस और अदर काइंड ऑफ क्राइसिस दैट द इम्पैक्ट ऑफ एनी काइंड ऑफ प्रॉब्लम इन वन कंट्री हैव गॉन एंड स्प्रेड टू अदर कंट्रीज एज वेल. So these are few risks, then there are political risks associated, country specific risks are there. So these risks are there when we talk about your free capital mobility. If you are going international, you're allowing others to come and invest in your markets. But you need to take certain measures so that these risks can be handled. Risk har cheez mein hoti hai, koi bhi business karoge risk hogi. Okay, banks loans dete hai, risk hai कि वो रिकवर नहीं हो पाएंगे, लोग डिफॉल्ट कर जाएंगे, तो आपको मेजर्स लेने हैं एंड दोज मेजर्स कैन हेल्प यू डील विद द रिस्क्स. हर चीज़ के साथ अगर आप किसी कोई भी टाइप की रिस्क ले रहे हो तो आपको रिस्क मिटिगेट करने के लिए कुछ मेजर्स भी लेने होंगे. सो इफ आई टॉक अबाउट सम ऑफ द मेजर्स, दे कैन बी योर कैपिटल फ्लो मेजर्स विच इंक्लूड दैट यू कैन अवॉइड द रिस्की फ्लोज, यू कैन अवॉइड प्रोवाइडिंग शॉर्ट टर्म डेट, यू कैन गो फॉर लॉन्ग टर्म डेट. Okay, so these are some capital flow measures that can be taken which can prove to be helpful. Other than that, you can also go for some macroprudential measures like the Basel requirements. Okay, if I talk about Basel requirements, they say that you need to maintain certain capital. So you can maintain more amount of capital than the one prescribed through Basel norms, or you should keep the countercyclical buffers, capital buffers. We have discussed these in the Basel sessions which I took earlier. Then the liquidity coverage ratio is there, net stable funding ratio is there. So you maintaining them, keeping the buffers, capital buffers, can help you deal with the problems, the risks associated with the capital mobility which might come up. Then you have to manage your capital flows, you need to keep your policy more flexible, you need to keep the reserves which can prove to be helpful for you. And then you can have control over your debt. You can go for long-term debt rather than short-term debt because you might feel that the people might not be able to repay the short-term debt and you might face some issues. Moreover, you can give debts to the stable investors rather than the flighty investors like arbitrage traders and all. Aap stable investors, jaise ki pension fund ho gaye, insurance fund ho gaye, in sab ko apna aap debt, basically aap paisa lend kar sakte ho rather than lending them to your other traders जो आर्बिट्राज के लिए बेसिकली एक जगह से खरीदो दूसरी जगह सेल करो प्रॉफिट्स कमाने के लिए, इस पर्पज़ के लिए जो पैसा रेज कर रहे हैं. ओके, सो दीज आर फ्यू मेजर्स विच कैन बी टेकन टू डील विद द रिस्क एसोसिएटेड विद कैपिटल मोबिलिटी. Now, moving ahead to the next section of the speech, which talks about the capital flow management in India. India ka kya scenario raha hai capital flow mein? Kya India mein khub sare restrictions hai? Ya free mobility allowed hai? Okay, what's the level of capital flow management in India? Are there some restrictions or free mobility is allowed? So, if I talk about capital flow in India, all that started in early 90s when we moved towards liberalization. Okay, we shifted to a floating exchange rate regime. We freed up certain current account transactions. So it became easy to export, import, send and receive money. Okay, then came the Foreign Exchange Management Act, which not only codified the freeing of the current account, but some capital account transactions were also allowed, although they were controlled to a certain extent. But gradually we have moved ahead to liberalizing these capital account transactions as well. It has become so easy to make foreign direct investment elsewhere or attract foreign direct investments. Pehle bahut restrictions hote the FDI wagera pe. Ab ye procedure bhi kafi easy ho gaya. The things have been eased up. FDI has become less restricted, except there are certain sectoral gaps. There are restrictions in some areas. There are some areas where complete FDI is not allowed or where the FDI is not at all allowed, like for gambling and other such purposes, for certain areas like atomic energy sectors, FDI is not allowed. But other than that, the movement is quite free. It's quite easy to make and get FDI in your country or make it elsewhere. Okay, then if we talk about the foreign portfolio investors coming to your country to make foreign portfolio investment, then they were allowed to basically easily invest in equity earlier. In 1992s, it was easy to invest in the equity of other nations, but basically in India for the foreign investors. But then foreign portfolio investments were given the access to debt markets as well and further the G-Sex market. Pehle equity mein invest karna easy hota tha, fir usko debt instruments mein invest karna bhi easy hua ki foreign investors yahan ke invest kare. Fir G-Sex market bhi humne open ki. So aise hum log capital mobility ki taraf badh rahe hain. Apart from the sectoral caps, portfolio flows into equities are virtually unrestricted. It is easier to invest in the debt markets as well, but there are certain caps, certain restrictions which are there in order to make sure that the domestic economy is safeguarded. But we have become more liberalized. We have allowed the capital mobility to a greater extent. Kafi zyada easy ho gaya hai ek dusre ke saath ek dusri countries mein invest karna. There is an effort to liberalize the debt flows also with the introduction of the fully accessible route, which places no limit on non-resident investment in benchmark securities. So, ab securities may be fully accessible route ho gaya hai, jisse ki non-residents easily kuch type ki securities mein easily invest kar sakte hain. Then, in India, the focus has been on attracting FDI. So, rather than outflows, we are focusing more on the inflows because we want to attract more foreign capital. Our FDIs have outstripped the FPIs. Our equity flows have outstripped the debt flows. This is the status of India. So what conclusion can be derived about India's capital account management from here? See, India has come a long way in increasing the levels of convertibility on capital account. काफी इजी हो गया है इन्वेस्टमेंट करना. कन्वर्टेबिलिटी हमने काफी और कन्वर्टेबिलिटी के रिस्पेक्ट में इंप्रूव किया है. इट हैज ब्रॉडली अचीव द डिजायर्ड आउटकम फॉर द पॉलिसी चॉइसेस इट मेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ अचीविंग द स्टेबल कंपोजिशन ऑफ फॉरेन कैपिटल इनफ्लो. सो काफी स्टेबल है हमारी कंट्री में आने वाले फॉरेन कैपिटल इनफ्लोज. एट द सेम टाइम वी नीड सम फंडामेंटल शिफ्ट्स इन ऑर्डर टू मेक द ट्रेड मोर free, more to make the things more easier, we need to work on certain areas, make certain changes. But when we are moving ahead to more capital account convertibility, obviously the risks will come up. So we have to take measures to deal with those risks as well. So jitna zyada hum convertibility ko aur ease karenge, jitna zyada easy kar denge hum ek dusre ke saath ek dusri countries mein invest karna ya wahan se investments attract karna, utni zyada risks bhi arise hongi aur un risks se deal karne ke liye hame aur zyada measures bhi lene honge, be it certain capital flow measures, certain macro prudential measures. So we need to take various steps to improve on this very area. Okay, now this was all about the speech. Second question is again related to BOP. So it's basically a question related to your static portion on BOP. So we have to identify the incorrect statement on BOP. First one says it's a record of all economic transactions of country with rest of the world during a defined period. Yes, this is correct. BOP transactions are classified under two major heads, current and capital account. This is also correct. Third one says BOP capital account covers export and import of goods, factor income. No, the current account covers that. So this statement is incorrect. We had to identify the incorrect one only. So only third is incorrect. Answer is option B. Now moving on to next question and next topic of the day. Which of the following principles should be kept in mind while designing the policy and the structure of the central bank digital currencies? So we all know that different countries are there that are looking forward to accept these central bank digital currency, to come up with their own central bank digital currency as an alternative to all the private cryptocurrencies out there, which are not at all safe and reliable. We have had a discussion on central bank digital currency many days back, where I told you that it's basically a complement to your fiat currency, to your paper currency which you are having, or the coins you are having. It's basically an electronic form of that currency. ठीक है, हमारे जो paper notes होते हैं या coins होते हैं, उसके एक alternate नहीं कहेंगे, उसको complement करने का एक medium है central bank digital currency. उसी करेंसी का डिजिटल फॉर्म है. हमें फिजिकली वो करेंसी ना होल्ड करके हम उसको डिजिटली होल्ड कर सकते हैं. दैट वुड बी अ सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी. सो मेनी कंट्रीज आर देयर, मेनी सेंट्रल बैंक्स आर देयर ऑफ डिफरेंट कंट्रीज हु आर थिंकिंग ऑफ कमिंग अप विद देयर ओन सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसीज. ओके, अभी तक इंडिया ने अपनी खुद की सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी के साथ इंडिया नहीं आई है, बट वी आर ऑल्सो लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड कि हम अपनी सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी के साथ आए. So when we are designing the policy, the structure of central bank digital currency, we should keep certain principles in mind. So we have to identify those principles from here. Why I am discussing it? It's because recently the G7 meeting was held. G7 is basically the intergovernment forum which comprises of Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, US and UK. So these seven nations together comprise G7. Their finance ministers and central bankers met and they were talking about the central bank digital currency. So they said that there are certain principles which should be followed when we are devising the policy for CBDCs, central bank digital currencies. So they mentioned about 13 policies. आपस में उनका डिस्कशन हो रहा था CBDCs पे, तो उन्होंने कहा कि कुछ प्रिंसिपल्स हमें फॉलो करनी चाहिए जब हम सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी का प्रॉपर स्ट्रक्चर बनाएंगे या प्रॉपर पॉलिसी बनाएंगे. सो वो 13 प्रिंसिपल्स आज हम यहाँ पे डिस्कस करने वाले हैं. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल टॉकिंग अबाउट CBDCs, सो इट्स बेसिकली अ लीगल टेंडर इशूड बाय सेंट्रल बैंक इन द डिजिटल फॉर्म. ओके, सो इट्स सेम एज फिएट करेंसी बट its form is different than the paper form. It's basically an electronic form. So paise physical form mein na hold karke electronically hold karna, that's a CBDC. Okay, now we'll be discussing about those principles. Recently the G7 met in Washington during the IMF and World Bank meetings. So ye seven nations ki aapas mein talk hui hai IMF aur World Bank ki annual meeting mein, where they talked about CBDCs. So they said that the central bank money in the form of CBDCs could act as a liquid safe settlement asset complementing cash. Cash ko complement karne wala ye digital medium hoga ye CBDCs, and it's going to bring various benefits. So they said that along with the benefits, it raised certain issues as well. So certain principles must be kept in mind while we are designing this CBDC structure or its policy. So let's see what are these 13 principles. But before that, let me clarify that no G7 authority has decided to issue a CBDC. Okay, अभी तक इन G7 nations ने भी खुद की CBDC लाने की मतलब introduce नहीं की है, but they were just having a discussion on the same. It might be that in near future they might come up with their own central bank digital currency like RBI is also thinking. Private cryptocurrencies have created a lot of problem. Okay, they are not at all safe. Then there are issues with respect to different money laundering activities, criminal activities undergoing. So we need a more reliable and a safer option. Now, what 13 principles should be kept in mind while designing the CBDCs? First is monetary and financial stability. So हम लोग जब भी ये सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी इंट्रोड्यूस करेंगे, हमें ये ध्यान में रखना है कि इससे RBI की या कोई और कंट्री अगर इंट्रोड्यूस करती है तो वहाँ के सेंट्रल बैंक कि कोई पावर हार्म ना हो जिससे कि मॉनेटरी या फाइनेंशियल स्टेबिलिटी नेगेटिवली इम्पैक्ट हो सकती है. ओके, सो इजिली CBDCs के साथ साथ बाकी पॉलिसीज भी इम्प्लीमेंट हो जाए, ऐसा हमें CBDC को डिज़ाइन करना है. CBDCs should be designed in a way that it supports the fulfillment of the policy objectives, public policy objectives, and not impede the ability of central bank and not harm the monetary and financial stability. So CBDCs should be introduced in such a manner that they don't create a problem for the central bank, they don't hamper your monetary or financial stability. Okay, smoothly they should get merged with the existing payment and settlement system. Second is that we need to keep in mind the legal and the governance frameworks. So what G7 wants is that the IMF and the financial system should guide the operation of CBDC for transparency, rule of law, economic governance. So ये जो भी हमारी CBDCs हम introduce करेंगे, हमें ये ध्यान में रखना है कि ये transparent हों, rules, regulations को properly follow करें, governance norms को follow करें. So we need to make sure that proper governance is there, proper rules, regulations are there. Okay, good governance is very important when you are coming up with any new system. Then is data privacy. Now, instead of holding the money in a physical form, you will be having it in a digital form. Okay, somewhere it will be stored. With that, the information of people will also be stored. Suppose I am having that money, so some data associated with me would also be there on the digital platforms. So it's very important to make sure that our data is kept secure, data privacy is maintained. Then operational resilience and cyber security should be kept in mind. When you are using the digital platforms, there are chances of cyber hack. So, आपको सारे basically सारी चीज़ें follow करनी है जिससे कि आपकी cyber security maintained रहे, cyber hacks से आपका information protected रहे. Then is operational resilience. You are using the online platforms. If transaction somehow gets stuck over if your transactions get stuck, then it can have a major impact. If you are making investment elsewhere, you are using CBDCs, then those transactions will be impacted, your trade might be impacted. So you need to make sure that you have good infrastructure, operational systems are strong. आप कोई भी transaction CBDCs के through कर रहे हो, कोई glitch हो गया तो आपकी वो transaction process नहीं हो पाएगी. उसको आप investment के लिए, trade के लिए use कर रहे थे, तो वो आपका trade, आपका investment hamper होगी, जिस वजह से आपको loss हो सकता है. So आपको ऐसा infrastructure develop करना है कि आपके operations smoothly run करें, कोई glitches ना हो, उन glitches को prevent किया जा सके. Then is competition. Now you have your physical currency, you have your different payment and settlement systems, you are making payments through UPIs, through IMPS, and different platforms are there which we are using. So we need to make sure that CBDCs are a healthy competition. They should not overrule all these mediums which are existing. They should not be an alternative, rather be a complement system which is added. ओके, हमारे बहुत से मीडियम्स हैं जिसके थ्रू हम पेमेंट्स करते हैं, हमारे फिजिकल नोट्स हैं, हम UPI वगैरह ट्रांजैक्शंस करते हैं. सो CBDCs को उनका एक ऑल्टरनेटिव बन के नहीं आना, उनके साथ उनको कॉम्प्लीमेंट करना है. एक इट शुड मर्ज विद द सिस्टम इन अ स्मूथ मैनर बेसिकली. देन इज इलिसिट फाइनेंस. वी शुड मेक श्योर दैट दीज CBDCs आर प्रोटेक्टेड एंड दे सम मैकेनिज्म्स आर देयर टू मेक श्योर दैट दिस मनी इज नॉट गेटिंग यूज्ड इन वेरियस wrongdoings, in various wrong activities. The CBDCs will have to carefully integrate the need for faster and more accessible, safer and cheap payments. Therefore, there has to be a commitment to mitigate their use in any kind of a crime. So CBDCs ke saath associated aisa system hona chahiye ki iska kahin misuse ho, kahin criminal activities mein use ho, to wo identify ho sake, in fact prevent ho sake. Moving ahead to the next principle, it's related to the spillovers. CBDCs need to be designed such that they avoid risks of harm to the international monetary and financial system, including monetary sovereignty and financial stabilities of other countries. Now, using CBDCs, you might be able to make payments internationally also. So there are interconnections between the countries. So you need to make sure that your monetary stability is also maintained and that of other countries as well. Then is energy and environment. CBDC infrastructure must ensure proper energy usage. this was a major problem associated with the cryptocurrencies. If you remember, Elon Musk tweeted about it, that how much energy Bitcoin minting is using. Bitcoin ko mint karne ke liye bahut energy consume hoti thi, jis wajah se unhone ye tweet bhi kiya tha ki isko use nahi karna chahiye, and we saw a major dip in the Bitcoin value. So we need to make sure that our CBDC infrastructure makes proper use of energy. Okay. उसका अननेसेसरी इम्प्रॉपर यूज नहीं होना चाहिए. एनवायरमेंट प्रोटेक्शन शुड ऑल्सो बी आर गोल. देन इज डिजिटल इकोनॉमी एंड इनोवेशन. सो CBDCs शुड इंश्योर और एक्ट एज अ कैटलिस्ट फॉर योर रिस्पॉन्सिबल इनोवेशन इन डिजिटल इकोनॉमी. इंश्योर इंटरऑपरेबिलिटी विद एग्जिस्टिंग एंड फ्यूचर पेमेंट सॉल्यूशंस. सो हमें एक अच्छे डिजिटल इनोवेशन के साथ आना है. We have to come up with a good digital innovation which will support our existing systems and any future payment systems as well. We need to create a digital economy, and this CBDCs should be properly planned and implemented to ensure innovation in the field of digital, of going digital. Then is financial inclusion. So CBDCs should focus on those people as well who are underserved or in unserved sections of society. We should not exclude them. अब हम लोग central bank digital currencies के साथ आएं, तो हम कोई type की technology use करेंगे, तो हमें ये make sure करना है कि जो unserved, underserved sections हैं, जिन तक से internet नहीं पहुँच पाता, उन तक भी ये benefit कैसे पहुँच पाए. We have to keep all those people in mind and then come up with some structure for our CBDCs. Then is the transactions with the private sector. Any CBDC supporting payments between authorities and the public must do so in fast, inexpensive, transparent, safe manner at all times. So we will be using CBDCs to make transactions with different private sector people. We will be making the payments. So we need to make sure that a safe, transparent system is implemented. Then is cross-border functionality. Now, if we have to make payments internationally, the conversion is there. Some costs are associated. So we need to make sure that this conversion becomes easy with CBDCs. We can easily make international payments without the need to convert the currencies. Okay. And then is international development. CBDCs deployed for the provision of international development assistance must safeguard key public policies of countries issuing and receiving digital money. At the same time, provide adequate transparency about the nature, design, features of particular CBDCs. So CBDCs should be framed keeping in mind the benefits of both the countries which are going to use it. Okay, how they will be issued, how they will be received, how the transparency should be maintained, how the problems associated with its implementation could be handled. Everything should be kept in mind, taking into consideration the development perspective of both the countries using and providing the CBDCs. Okay, so these were few principles. Now coming back to our question, which of these principles should be kept in mind? Obviously, we need to make sure that CBDCs don't hamper your monetary and financial stability. They focus on cross-border functionality. They focus on cybersecurity, operational resilience, and they focus on financial inclusion as well. Okay, reaching out to all the people, even if they are underserved or unserved sections of society. So all these principles should be kept in mind. So answer is option E. This was all for today's session. I hope it was useful for you. So we discussed numerous topics today. We talked about the BOP. We talked about the major components of BOP, the current and capital account. We talked about the convertibility. Then we talked about your CBDCs. I hope this session made these topics clear for you. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.